Yeah, it's YouTube live now. Yes.
Can we start?
Yeah, Nikhil ji, can you?
So, it's my, shall we start? Can we start?
Yeah, ji, can we start? She's asking.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, viewers. Welcome on this main Chakrabarti. So today we have organized.
I think he's having some network problem. Yeah, he's at Siliguri. Probably having some network issue.
It's yeah, ma'am, okay. You can start. I'll start.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, it's my pleasure to welcome today. We have two eminent speakers who will be speaking to us on autism mimics as well as the treatment of autism. So we have with us Dr. Rafat Trivedi. She is a consultant pediatric neurologist and epileptologist at Max Hospital, Gurgaon. And at Sitaram Bhartiya Hospital, Delhi, and Triton Hospital, Delhi. And we also have with us another eminent developmental specialist and neurologist, Dr. Priyanka Jain. And she's at Ramshila Narayana Super Speciality Hospital in Delhi. And she's also the director of Tulip Clinics, Noida. And she's the director of JMC Institute of Medical Sciences, Meerut. And she's also the secretary of International Society for Blind and Handicapped Relief. So I invite the speakers to start the session.
Thank you.
Dr. Rafat, please, you'll be starting first.
Okay.
So you can start. Just
1 minute, Rafat, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Poonam. You'll have to enable screen sharing.
1 minute, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, you can do it now.
This is too big.
Is my screen visible?
Not yet.
No, ma'am.
No?
No.
Rikya ji, you made her host, na? Host?
Madam is co-host now. Madam can present it, yeah. There should not be any issue.
So...
Just click on this screen sharing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's coming.
Is it visible now?
Yeah, visible. Yes, absolutely fine.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much, South Delhi IIP Pediatric Group, Poonam ma'am, Dr. Sankal, for this opportunity. Thank you, BryoBliss. And I'll be talking about autism mimics and role of EEG in autism. So just to quickly start with it, let's see the definition of autism. So the definition is persistent defect in deficits in social communication and social interaction, which are there in multiple contexts. Along with that, they have restrictive and repetitive pattern of behavior and interest. These deficits are not explained by any global developmental delay or intellectual disability, and generally the regression occurs between 18 to 24 months of age. So now moving to case one. This is a two-month-old boy who had come with a complaint of speech delay. So the parents said that mera bachcha bolta nahi hai. On examination, his gross motor development was more normal. Fine motor, he was clumsy. He was not able to handle spoon that well. He was not very good with dogs. Social and communication-wise, he had poor eye contact. He did respond, but the response was inconsistent. And he tended to remain his own little world. The need-based communication was there, and there was some self-stimulatory behavior, like he was rocking and spinning around and not interested in what was happening around. So on inquiry, they also gave a history of screen time. This was just, you know, after the lockdown, 6 months, 7 months into the lockdown, they said that the screen time had increased considerably because both the parents were working and they did not have any help at home. And on examination, there was no dysmorphism, no neurocutaneous markers. The eye contact was present but inconsistent. The CNS exam was normal. So, and impression was, could be suspected on autism spectrum disorder, but he was told to stop screens completely. Parents were told to interact with him one-on-one, and he was started on occupation therapy and sensory integration. He did improve very significantly in 1 month's time, and he is completely normal now, nine to 10 months into the illness. So this was actually precipitated by a lot of screen exposure. So we all know that AAP does not recommend screen exposure in children below 2 years of age, except for video calling. And in children from 2 to 5 years of age, we should limit the screen to about 1 hour per day. That also high programming, programming, and co-viewing with children, young children helps. So too much of screen time can precipitate language delay, social interaction and communication delay, and can be a biggest mimic, particularly in the current scenario. So I just thought of incorporating this case, and this child is doing quite well now. Now, moving on to our second case. This is a 7-year-old boy born of a non-consanguineous union, normal birth history. He had come with the complaints of speech delay. Parents noticed that he had this first words at 4 years of age, but the speech was not relevant to the topic. So it was just a rote memory, or you know, singing out a rhyme or a song, but he did not respond to commands. His social and cognitive milestones were poor as compared to the peers, and he had behavioral problems like hyperactivity and impulsivity. A family history, there was a strong family history of mental retardation on the maternal side, and on examination, he was dysmorphic. He had elongated face, big ears. He was hyperactive, the eye contact was poor, and the command following was not there. He was all over in the OPD, running here and there, not knowing what to do, totally in his own world. So impression was autism spectrum disorder, ADHD, but secondary to Fragile X, or which is a syndromic autism. So we sent a Fragile X PCR, which came out to be positive. There were more than 200 repeats, and he was diagnosed with Fragile X syndrome. So just a brief about Fragile X. It is the second most common cause of intellectual disability, and maybe the most common intellectual disability, mental retardation, and autism in male children. 15 to 20% of them have autism, and the diagnosis is by clinical features. The history on maternal side with family members, males being affected. So the males are affected. Females can be carriers and can be affected too, but the degree of mental retardation is much lower in females when they are affected. And the genetic testing that we do is the Fragile X PCR and the sudden blood test. Now moving to our case 3. This is a 5-year-old child who was developmentally normal, girl child, developmentally normal till the first 2 years of life. Noted some speech delay right to begin with and regression after 2 years of age. So right now, at 5 years, she did not have any meaningful speech. Her eye contact was very poor, but she did recognize her parents. Repetitive, non-successful hand movements were there. The parents gave history of loss of hand function after 2 years of age. On head circumference, she was microcephalic, not that, but between the 3rd and the 50th centile. And this was her video. So I would want you to concentrate on the hand movements which are there. Look at this repetitive hand movement. Not doing any purposeful hand movements, and all she's doing is this hand picking movements or these stereotypies with their day. So these stereotypies, along with microcephaly, could be an indicator for Rett syndrome, and we did her genetic testing for Rett syndrome, and the MECP2 mutation was positive, and she was detected with Rett syndrome. So classic Rett syndrome is a progressive neurodevelopmental disorder affecting girls, and it has 4 stages. The first stage is at developmental arrest, which happens around 6 to 18 months of age. Though some children can be delayed right from the start, they have microcephaly in the second stage. They have regression of milestones,
he is no more.
Attention. they have loss of hand function. So basically the purposeful hand movements are lost and they start doing some stereotypies, putting hand in the mouth or picking on the hand. So these stereotypies are present, and then till 2 to 10, about 3 to 10 years of age, they remain stationary and followed by motor deterioration after 10 years of age. The genetic testing is done by NGS or next gen sequencing, and you can identify the mutation. So comorbidities along with Rett syndrome is they can have respiratory difficulties, they can have events of hyperapnea and hypoapnea. Epilepsy is one big comorbidity which is present with Rett syndrome, and about 80 to 90% of children or girls affected with Rett syndrome would develop epilepsy and would need treatment for that. Oromotor dysfunction is very common, autonomic disturbances are very common, somatic growth failure, microcephaly and regression, sleep problems, bruxism. So these are all comorbidities that are associated with Rett syndrome. But it is very important to make this syndromic diagnosis or genetic confirmation for prognostication of the parents also. Now, coming to case number 3. She is an 18-month-old girl. She came with a history of global developmental delay. She had an eye contact again, but it was inconsistent. She had autistic features, and the parents typically say that yes, she does not respond to us. हम बुलाते हैं तब वो देखती नहीं है इतना, अपनी दुनिया में रहती है, अपना अपना करती, but बहुत happy child है, बहुत smile करती है, बहुत हंसती है. So this was the history given by the parents. General examination, she was fair in complexion. She had laughing cells in the OPD. CNS exam showed the hypotonia with preserved reflexes, and she was ataxic, not able to stand without support, and she had a very wobbly stretcher when she stood up. So this is her video. So look at the faces. She is very fair. She is in her own world. We are trying to talk to her, but she is not responding, not responsive. Intermittently, when the mother will talk, she will just, you know, smile or maybe look at her or look at the person. She has this, you know, self-stimulatory behaviors, and she also did have some laughing spells. So this made us suspect Angelman syndrome in her, and we did a FISH for Angelman's, which detected a heterozygous deletion in the SNRPN SNRPN location, and she was diagnosed with Angelman syndrome. So Angelman syndrome, typically children are normal at birth. The developmental delay starts by around 6 to 12 months of age. They have this typical dysmorphic feature that I have shown in the video also. Frequent laughter is there, very happy child. Neurologically, they can have intellectual impairment, speech impairment, ataxia. Seizures are present in about over 80% of children with Angelman syndrome, and with the onset in the first few years of life. So very important to keep this in mind, and if they have behavioral deterioration, even without seizures, it is mandatory to do an EEG just to see what it is. Genetic testing is again by FISH. You can do DNA. It is a uniparental disomy. DNA methylation imprints can be done, and if these are negative, then NGS can be done for the ubiquitin sequence analysis. Coming to case number 4. Again, she is a 6-year-old girl child with global developmental delay, and all of these cases that we saw were syndromic causes of developmental delay or autism, but there are many more but cannot be covered. So syndromic associations of autism can be there. It is very vital to pick that up to get them prognostication, and also for prenatal genetic testing, it is very important to suspect it. Now, case number 4, she was a 6-year-old girl child with global developmental delay and seizures on and off. The parents distinctly said that the development was normal until 7 months of age, and right now the eye contact was poor. Cognitively, she was very poor. She had stereotypies and self-stimulatory behavior. On examination, her general examination were positive for neurocutaneous markers. So as you can see, these are the adenoma sebaceum, which is seen coming up. And there are the ash leaf macules, caffeolae spots, and the chagrin patch, which is the orange peel appearance on the lumbosacral area. So we suspected, yes, these are clear-cut markers for tuberous sclerosis. But on inquiry, because we had a history of developmental regression at 7 months of age, on inquiry, we did ask whether she had any history of spasms, kya wo chonkti thi, kya wo chamakti thi. Then the parents said, ki, haan, wo bahut darti thi. this was the history that the parents gave. So maybe that infantile spasms early on were missed, and which could be the contributing factor for the developmental lag, for the cognitive delay in this child. Though tuberous sclerosis in itself can also have features of autism apart from epilepsy, but this must have definitely delayed her cognitive milestones or worsened it more. These were the MRI for the child, and these are these cortical tubers which are seen at the at the white matter and gray matter junction. These are the subependymal nodules which are characteristic for patients with tuberous sclerosis. Her genetic testing came out to be positive for TSC1 complex. So TSC is a genetic disorder affecting the cellular proliferation and migration. It is autosomal dominant. So when a child comes to you and you see, okay, fine, you're suspecting tuberous sclerosis, just have a look at the parents and you may see the adenoma sebaceum, because the spectrum of tuberous sclerosis is very mild, very wide. You can get mild disease, moderate disease to severe impairments. So the parents may have just have those adenoma sebaceums or the caffeolae, and they are mentally or everything is normal with them. Clinical feature-wise, tuberous sclerosis almost affects all the systems. So neurological, we have discussed retinal hematomas or astrocytomas can be there, renal angiomyolipomas can be there, pulmonary involvement, eye involvement a lot more, atrial myxomas, and these heart myxomas can be picked up on fetal ultrasound also. And there are many more things coming up as to the prenatal diagnosis of TSC and starting the anti-epileptics early so that they don't develop infantile spasms and they have a better course of the neurological development and etc. And the testing is by genetic testing for TSC1 complex. So now, to emphasize about the epileptic encephalopathy or the infantile spasms, we did see that this case, this child had infantile spasms and was missed. So just a short video on infantile spasms. These are the spasms which, seizures which are flexor or extensors, comes when the child is going off to sleep or when the child is awakening from sleep. They occur in clusters. So like you can see, this child is having this spasms in clusters, 1, 2, 3. His facial expression changes during the spasms. So why is it very important to pick up infantile spasms? I think we all know about it and how disastrous the effect can be. So we should definitely, and these are the seizures which parents miss. So pediatricians are the first line of contact, point of contact with the parents. So at least in the high-risk babies, we should always tell them about the possibility of, having these jerks, and if jerks, record a video and come back to us immediately, because the treatment interval plays a very big role in the cognitive outcome of these children. So these are epileptic encephalopathy characterized by spasms, developmental regression. So they have social regression. They may become just autistic. And the classical EEG pattern, which you can see as hypsarrhythmia over here, a chaotic, angry looking EEG with burst suppression, multi-regional epileptic form discharges. And if not treated on time, can lead to severe developmental delay, autistic traits, global developmental delay, intellectual delays, etc. Now, this is a 3.5-year-old boy who was normal birth and development, came with a history of regression of language milestones. So the parents said that he did not follow commands or he did not respond to his name by 2 months of, since the past 2 months. Till 3 years and 3 months, he was absolutely all right. Now, when we call him, he doesn't listen. When the doorbell rings, he doesn't listen. He doesn't, run come to see his favorite song or his favorite rhyme. He doesn't do that anymore. They also noted that he had some movements in sleep and he's become a little more clumsy, that while walking, he just suddenly drops down. They also noted a change in behavior. He had become aggressive and irritable. He started hitting people. And examination, there was no dysmorphism. CNS exam was normal. A hearing test was already done, which was normal. So this is one case scenario. We try to remember this. And I will just say a different case. Again, this is a 4-year-old boy who was previously normal. Complained of loss of speech for past 3 months. He was not able to understand commands. He used to respond to his name, but very inconsistently. Intermittent episodes of behavioral deterioration, fear, anxiety. The child would just howl, scream so much. And he also had the stereotypical hand movements. He started picking on his hands like this. So parents thought maybe it is COVID. And the family members were down with COVID, so maybe the child is very anxious. So they just took him to Shimla for a break, and he improved a bit, but he was never normal. And the symptoms kept waxing and waning. So in both these cases, the thing is that they came with speech delay, they came with behavioral problems, they came with additional problems of fear, anxiety, and stereotypies, etc. So a differential diagnosis would be autoimmune encephalitis, especially in the current scenario where the infections are very high. The post-infectious autoimmune encephalitis we are seeing more often now. Epileptic encephalopathy, like electrographic status epilepticus of slow wave sleep. Subacute sclerosing pan encephalitis, onset of any progressive neurodegenerative disorder, or the least possibility was of late onset autistic regression. So the first case wherein he had verbal agnosia, this case we decided to do an EEG. His awake EEG was okay. Did show some parietal and temporal discharges, but as soon as we went into the sleep pattern, it showed continuous run of this spike and wave discharges, and it was an epileptic encephalopathy. So verbal agnosia along with epileptic encephalopathy, we thought, and the MRI normal, basic metabolic normal, we thought of an epileptic encephalopathy, which is Landau-Kleffner syndrome. So we started him on anti-epileptics like clobazam and valproate, gave him a pulse of methylprednisolone. He did improve, but not completely. We gave him IVIG, and post-IVIG, we saw very significant improvement. The child started talking, and he was almost okay. Then on follow-up, he was on valproate and clobazam, and he did have intermittent episodes of within, 3-4, sometimes 6 months, sometimes 8 months, he used to come with this regression. We used to give him IVIG and he used to be all right. Or LKS, which is characterized by verbal agnosia and in a typically developing child and accompanied by seizures usually. So maybe those night movements that the parents noticed were seizures. The fall that the parents noticed were the drop attacks which were there because of this epileptic encephalopathy. So these can have again a waxing and waning pose, and the EEG is very characteristic, which will show a continuous slow spike and wave in sleep. The treatment is immunomodulation, anti-epileptic drugs, and sometimes resistant cases, we do surgeries. So this was epileptic encephalopathy. The two cases that we discussed were infantile spasms and Landau-Kleffner syndrome. So these are epileptic encephalopathies, emphasizes the importance of prolonged EEGs in children. So if we would have done just an awake EEG, we would have not reached the diagnosis. A prolonged EEG in a children to make a diagnosis of these encephalopathies so that they are treated on time. Because more the time delay, the less is the neurocognitive or developmental outcome in these children. Now coming back to the case where he had behavioral problems and family affected with COVID, they thought anxiety. In this child, because of the waxing and waning symptoms, we also did EEG on this child, an overnight prolonged EEG, which showed a very beautiful architecture with sleep spindles and everything. So EEG was absolutely okay. He was admitted and investigated for autoimmune encephalitis. Basic metabolic workup was normal. CSF routine was normal. Autoimmune panel was sent, and in strong suspicion of autoimmune encephalitis, he was pulsed with, he was given IVIG and pulse methylprednisolone. And furthermore, his NMDA VGKC anti-GAD came out negative, but his TPO antibodies were positive, and he is still on immunosuppression and is continuing to show improvement. And we had to, escalate the immunosuppression to him. Right now, he's on rituximab. So again, this also emphasizes in both the cases, the thing different from autism was the age of onset. Though it can occur in younger children also, but the age of onset was roughly around 3.5-4 years of age. So if the children with autism, they show regression a little later, we should have red flag indicators that maybe something else. Again, a sudden explosive onset of behavioral problems in a previously typically normal child should make us think whether it is epileptic encephalopathy, whether it is, autoimmune encephalitis, and many other autoimmune things like pandas, pans, etc., can present like this. Now, coming to the seventh case, which is 8-year-old boy. He's 8-year-old boy. He complains of behavioral problems. Motor milestones, he was delayed to start with. He walked at 15-month, jumped and running after 2.5-3 years of age. They had noted hyperactivity and poor eye contact since the early age. So he was being treated for ADHD and autism. Noted increase in aggression for the past 2 years. And also he started with falls while walking. So he consulted a pediatric orthopedician and was referred to me by the orthopedician. So on examination, his facies was mildly coarse. He has a thick lower lip, hirsutism. He was toe walking. He had TA contractures, tendonitis contractures, and there was some elbow deformity which was coming up. So we reviewed the MRI brain, which showed periventricular white matter hyperintensities, which was done a few years back, which could be normal, but now in retrospect was thinking that these periventricular hyperintensities could be the disease progress. Spectroscopy was done, which was normal. The differential was to rule out neurodegenerative disorder like mucopolysaccharidosis type 3 or Sanfilippo syndrome. So this Sanfilippo syndrome, we sent a urine MPS spot test, which was positive. And then we sent a genetic testing for Sanfilippo, which came out to be positive for a pathogenic variant in Sanfilippo syndrome type C. So mucopolysaccharidosis, especially Sanfilippo syndrome, can behave like autism or ADHD to start with, but they can develop these symptoms. The coarse features and the bony deformities come much later as compared to the other type of MPS. And also they don't have any organomegaly. It is because of accumulation of glycosaminoglycans, and they are born normal and without any clinical features. They become aggressive during the toddler period or during the first few years of life, and then can develop bony deformities. The prognosis is guarded, and the diagnosis can be done by urine GAG or electrophoresis, quantitative enzyme analysis, and genetic testing for Sanfilippo. So it is very important because the chances of the family running through a genetic disease is very high in this syndrome. So the take-home message would be, look for other differentials when you have autistic features following pointers are there. So if there is autistic regression beyond 30 months of age, sudden onset of symptoms in a previously normal child, any child who is dysmorphic and has autism, any child who has a progressive course. So now we also in the OPDs, you know, we write known case of cerebral palsy, known case of autism. So we should make sure that on each follow-up, we try to look at the child and try to see if there are new pointers coming up which could suggest something which is progressive or something which is, you know, degenerative, because it will be important for prenatal testing, for prognostication of the parents, because they go through a hell lot of things during the course of illness and treatment. So if they know, they should do everything with a well-informed decisions should be taken. Now, very briefly, I'll touch upon this role of EEG in ASD. We all know that in autism spectrum disorder, epilepsy is the most common comorbidity, and more than one third of the children on autism spectrum suffer with epilepsy. And we have seen that children who suffer with epilepsy have a worse neurodevelopmental outcome. So over seizures agar hai, so obviously we will treat, we'll do an EEG. But there are many studies which are showing that when we do prolonged EEGs for children with autism, or maybe incorporating EEG for few hours with a few sleep stages, there are these subclinical EEG abnormalities. Subclinical EEG abnormalities meaning children on autism spectrum disorder without having seizures would have these EEG abnormalities. Now, when many of these studies were studies, there is evidence that these SEAs are more in number, then it leads to a worse clinical outcome in children. So they may not do well on therapy that much. So it is vital that if these subclinical EEG abnormalities are more, then we treat these EEG abnormalities. The other thing was to treat, to prevent the onset of seizures, but there is no evidence that we just start to prevent the onset of seizures. But definitely, if you are seeing a behavioral deterioration in the child with autism, definitely we should order for an EEG and see if the spike wave index is more. And if yes, then he needs to be started on the anti-epileptic drug. So again, to conclude the role of EEG in ASD, children with ASD and syndromic associations, yes, Rett's and Angelman have high incidence of epilepsy, so definitely an EEG is must. Other syndromes like Fragile X syndrome, 15q duplication syndrome, ring chromosome, and many other syndromic ASDs can have epilepsy and will need EEG. Again, if you are dealing with epileptic encephalopathies like Landau-Kleffner syndrome, infantile spasms, ESES, etc., EEG is needed. And again, with seizures, children with overt seizures and autistic children who were doing well but had sudden onset of behavioral deterioration, we should consider EEG in these children. And I will stop here and thank you so much for your time. Dr. Priyanka?
Yeah, Rafat ma'am, you can please stop sharing. Priyanka, yes. Ma'am.
I have pause share, right?
Not yet, ma'am.
Not yet.
Okay.
I have paused it. Stop share.
Now it's okay.
Can we ask a question?
Poonam ma'am, you are here. Should we take the questions now or at the end of the session?
We'll take them all at the end.
At the end. Okay.
We'll take all the questions.
Hello, good evening, everyone. I shall be talking about early identification and screening of autism. Dr. Rafat has covered very nicely, and this must have been an eye-opener for all of you. So, first of all, we should know what is the approach to early identification. If we are screening for autism, if we have to diagnose autism timely or we have to screen autism timely, then what are we supposed to look for? Children who are at risk, they are our priority. And why is it important to identify these children early? First of all, we should know what is normal for our age. If we are saying that our six-month-old child is not doing this thing, like autism is a socio-communicative disorder, if we are saying that six-month-old child is not producing any sound, not babbling, or not having eye contact, that means we should know what is normal for 6 months of age. How can parents or caregiver contribute into this? We should educate parents how to give home therapy, how to interact with your child, and what is the role of a pediatrician in developmental screening? Since these children are coming to us at the time of vaccination, so it's a duty to screen them developmentally and identify these problems timely. Investigations to rule out other problems, as Dr. Rafat already told, that there are certain mimics, so we need to undergo certain investigations to rule out other problems. And what are the screening tests for autism? So what is autism? Autism is a neurodevelopmental disorder which is characterized by qualitative impairment, not quantity. It is qualitative impairment in reciprocal social interactions. Reciprocal means if we are smiling, then child will also smile in reciprocation. Communication problems, like if we are saying something to child, child may communicate it non-verbally or verbally. Non-verbal communication comes before verbal communication. And restrictive repetitive behaviors like spinning, moving in circles, hand flapping, or child will have restrictive interest, like child will not enjoy playing with the whole car, he will be more interested in wheels, or in any other toy, child will be more interested in certain part, may have unusual responses to sensory experiences or perceptions. This is a very good point in history. Most of the parents are coming to us and they are saying, डॉक्टर साहब जब कुकर की सीटी बजती है तो बच्चे को बड़ी प्रॉब्लम होती है और ये अपने कान कवर कर लेता है, या सड़क पर कोई कार जा रही होती है और बहुत जोर से हॉर्न बज रहे होते हैं तो उसको प्रॉब्लम होती है और ये अपने कानों को कवर कर लेता है. सो चाइल्ड इज हैविंग ऑडिटरी हाइपर सेंसिटिविटी, इसलिए इस तरीके की वो प्रॉब्लम करता है. प्रेजेंटेशन मे वेरी फ्रॉम चाइल्ड टू चाइल्ड. ओपीडी में हम देखते हैं कि बहुत ज्यादा वेरिएशन होती है हर बच्चे में. सम चिल्ड्रन मे हैव मोर प्रॉब्लम विद द social rather than communication. They are able to speak 6 to 10 words. A few children who are coming late, they are able to speak one or two sentences also. Or on the other hand, there are some children who have social disconnect, and they are social disconnect, or there is so much of variation. And certain children may not have any restrictive and repetitive behaviors. Recognition of symptoms occurs in first 3 years of life. And most important is first 2 years of life. Especially you can suspect autism in first year of life also. You cannot diagnose it in first year of life. For that, child needs to be at least 18 months of age, but you can always suspect autism in first year of life. There are six or more symptoms. They are, as I told, that this is a socio-communicative disorder. So child may have problem with socialization. The child may have problem with using non-speech behaviors like non-verbal communication. Non-verbal communication is waving or showing facial expressions. Failure to develop peer relationship. This is also a very important point in history when we are interacting with parents and we are asking, does your child enjoy with other children? Is he playing with other children of your area? Or how is this child interaction with his sibling? Lack of spontaneous sharing of enjoyment or achievements with others. This is very, very natural. If we are happy, we share our happiness with others. But these children, they are not sharing their enjoyment or their happiness with others. Lack of social or emotional response. This is also a very important point in history. We always ask parents that, how is your child emotional reaction? Is your child giving more importance to mother? Does your child realize that mother is the most important person in his life? And is he able to understand his mother's emotion or any other close person's emotion? So generally, answer is no. Impairment in communication. This is the most common presentation with which parents are coming to us. They are saying that, doctor, our child is not able to speak. Child is 2 year old or child is 3 year old. Till now, child is not saying mamma and papa. On the other hand, few parents will come that, doctor, our child can speak 2-3 words like mummy, papa, but child is not using 2-word sentences and or his vocabulary is not more than these 2-3 words. So my first question is whether your child is having a meaningful speech or this is meaningless. Meaningful means child is saying mamma to mamma only or child is just saying mamma to anybody. So most of the time their answer is the child, child is saying mamma and papa, but he doesn't know who is mamma and who is papa. He's just saying it randomly. Second is difficulty with starting and continuing a conversation. Their personality is like a robot. They cannot start a conversation. They will just talk minimally. They will just use few words. Or if they are having good communication, then there are certain patients who have a good communication. Or over the past 6 or 10 months, they have started speaking full sentences also. But their conversation is limited. They will talk minimally, like, which is required. If they want something, then mamma pani do. They will not be excited. They will not have normal conversation. They will not share their emotions with their parents, or they will not gossip. Inflexible and repetitive use of language. This is ecolalia, like or jargon speech. If we ask them something, aapka naam kya hai, then they will repeat the question. And inflexible, they will not change it. They will keep on saying it. Lack of varied and spontaneous make-believe play. So we also ask this thing in history, that is your child having pretend play, or is your child is playing peekaboo or not? Restricted, repetitive and stereotypic patterns of behavior and interest in activities. They follow non-functional routines. Like if they are used to going to school through one route, they will follow that. If they are rigid to some extent, to this extent also, that if they are used to wearing their pant in one leg first, right leg first, then they will want that thing only. They have obsession with inflexible and limited interest. If they like one blanket, then they will want that blanket at bedtime only. Or they have obsession with parts of objects. As I said earlier, they will be more interested in meal. Or in other toys also, this is the case, they will be more interested in one part of the object. They have inflexible and repetitive movements. They can spin, they can do flapping, they can wiggle, or they will be shaking their body. Tiptoe walking is also quite common. I have seen tiptoe walking in almost 30% of my patients, and spinning is more common than tiptoe walking. Hand flapping and head banging. These children throw temper tantrums also, and they bang their head. They may have visual issues also. These are self-stimulatory behaviors. They will bring their fingers in front of the eyes, then they will play with their fingers. They will produce certain sounds. This is for auditory stimulation. Oral, they will take out their tongue again and again, or they will touch things before they will put paper in their mouth. Tactile self-stimulatory behavior also. They will rub certain clothes, smell. If they are being given some toy, they will try to smell that. So we ask these things also in history, whether whenever you are offering some toy or some object to your child, is your child putting that object in the mouth, or is your child is smelling that first before using? This is also very important, whom to screen. As I told earlier, children who have high risk, whose sibling has certain problem in the family, whose sibling has autism, or these high risk factors which I am going to enumerate, they need to be screened on priority basis, and they should be followed up. Children who are at high risk, like if sibling has a ASD, then there are 10%, 10 times more chances of having that having autism in that child. This is more common in male children. Comorbid genetic syndromes, like Dr. Rafat said, if child is having Fragile X syndrome, tuberous sclerosis, Down syndrome, then there are more chances of autism. And if there is a history of prenatal exposure, like if mother is having a convergence and she was on valproic acid during pregnancy, or she had torch infection during pregnancy, then we should be alert. And regression is quite common. It is 25 to 30% common in these children. So the history is very, very important. And most common time period for regression is 15 to 24 months of age. In routine OPD, most of the time, parents say that when my child was given vaccination at the time of at the age of 15 months, then my child was perfectly all right. My child was using few words also, but after that, my child has regressed. Child is not using those words now. And doctor, we can show you those videos also. My child was quite interactive before that, but now my child is not speaking. Change or delay in language or social awareness or behavior. Like same complaint, they will say that my child was doing all these things till 1 year of age. We did not suspect anything, any problem with our child till 1 year of age. But after 1 year of age, a child has changed totally. But when you take proper history, then you come to know that before 1 year also, this speech, this language wasn't meaningful. So it is very, very important to identify these children timely. Because the first 2 years of life are very, very important for any child's life. Oh. All of us know that brain growth is fastest first year of life. 90% of brain gets developed by 2 years of age. And now this is the concept that synapses are regenerable. If we stimulate one area, then that area gets stimulated and gets stronger and stronger by time. And the area which neuronal connections, which synaptic connections we are not using, they are pruned away with time. So it is always important to communicate with the child in first year of life and keep child away from the mobile or any sort of screen time, especially in first 2 years of life, because this is the time when brain growth is fastest and you can remodel your child's brain because of neuroplasticity. So you will be amazed to know that at birth, each neuron has 7,500 connections, and these connections increase rapidly and they become just double of adult brain. But if we are not using these synaptic connections, if we are not using them for language stimulation, for speech stimulation, for social interaction stimulation, then these synaptic connections are pruned away. And if we are showing them too much of a screen, then those synaptic connections are becoming stronger and stronger with time. And these children come with the problems of self-talking, because they are not following commands because they have not been used to it. So in these children, whenever we suspect that there is any neurodevelopmental delay, whether this is social delay or there is a communication issue, then we put these children to early intervention therapy, and they should not be delayed. We put them as early as 9 months of age. Sensory integration therapy, it has visual stimulation, auditory stimulation, vestibular stimulation, and we are giving home program to parents. It is very important to educate parents and give them home program, because if they are going for therapy, they are going for 45 minutes only. And most of the time we have seen that parents are juggling the whole day. They are jumping from one therapy to another therapy. Whole day they are spending in therapies. And by the time they come back home, they don't have any quality interaction with their child. They are also very much tired, and child is also very much tired. So this is also very, very important to give home program to parents, that they should also make an effort. They should not be totally dependent on taking them to the therapist, because that is only 45 minutes of job. And in corona period, most of the children are not taking any therapy. If mother is trained to do these things at home, then it can be very much beneficial for the child. So if child is very hyperactive, a child needs occupational therapy. These type of therapies depend on the condition of the child, whether child needs a speech therapy or child needs occupational therapy or child needs special education. So this is being decided by a pediatrician. So parents are primary givers, and this is our duty as a pediatrician, that we should always do developmental surveillance, since these children are coming to us for vaccination. So at the 6 months of age, we are earlier also at 1.5 of month of age, and they are coming for vaccination. We should look for their social interaction. We should look how are they responding to surroundings. We should always give importance to parents' concern. We should not adopt that approach, wait and watch. No, 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 your child will come out of this problem. These are early years. Child will be normal after some time. So no, we should not, neither parents nor pediatricians. So this is about a child. Meenal is a healthy 1-year-old child, but her parents are worried about her development, because she's not doing many things that her older brother did at her age. So they are comparing Meenal with her brother, like she's not playing peekaboo, she's not mimicking expressions and gestures. So Meenal's mom and dad, they are trying to engage her with toys, songs and games, but nothing is working, and she's not taking interest in anything. She is sitting alone. In fact, she rarely makes eye contact. And although her hearing has been checked, that was found to be normal, but she doesn't babble, and she makes other baby noises which nobody understands. And Meenal needs to be checked out by a child development specialist right away. So this is the time when you should interact. This is the time when you should intervene, and you should take it seriously. So don't accept wait and see approach. So you can suspect, you can not diagnose, but you can suspect autism quite early. It may be something else, but you have to start intervention at this time. Like this was a 4-month-old child who had septicemia at the time of birth. Child had no eye contact. I was sitting in front of the child, but child was sitting somewhere else. There was no neck holding, and child was not responding to any sound. This was a 9-month old. This is a 9-month old child who had a birth history of asphyxia. At 9 months, child is not able to sit. Child was not taking interest in any person who was around. Child was just in his own world, and there was no eye contact, no social smile. This is a 5-month-old child who was referred to me by some pediatrician, and it was a twin delivery. We were standing in front of the child, but child was in himself only. Child was not interested in any toy. We were ringing a bell also. Child was not showing any response to any sort of sound, no eye contact, nothing. So we put this child on early intervention therapy. So developmental surveillance is must. So periodic examination, like you can do at six weeks, then again a child is coming to you on 10 weeks, then again 14 weeks, then 6 months, then 9 months, then 15, 18, and 24 months. So before saying abnormal, this is very important to know what is normal. So I will not go into details, but when do you suspect? So if a child is 3.5 months to 4 months old and child is not having any social smile, then it should ring a bell that, yeah, something is problematic and you should call that child for proper follow-up. So at 6 months, if there is no babbling, no sound, then again, you should follow up that child. From 6 months to 9 months of age, if child is not showing any emotional bonding with parents, especially with mother, and child is not showing any response to sound, there is no startle when there is a ringing of bell, then you should be alert. At 12 months of age, if there are no gestures, generally child is waving, child is showing gestures, child is having stranger anxiety also. So if there are no gestures, then this is red flag sign. At 15 months, if there is no eye contact, no facial expression, no response to name, and no meaningful one word. Ideally, at 1 year of age, child should be able to say mama, papa, two words. But even at 15 months, child is not using even a single word, meaningful word, then this is a matter of concern. At 18 months of age, if there is no joint attention is if we are showing some good toy to child or something interesting to child, then child should look at that point and then look at you again. So if it 18 months, child is not having joint attention, child is not having any pretend play, no peekaboo, then this is something for which we should send this child to a developmental pediatrician. Up to 24 months, if child is not following any instructions, child is not interested in surroundings, child is not following any commands, then this is a serious matter. By 2 years of age, child should be able to use two-word sentences. So regression of any kind is a serious matter. So because this is a very, very common point in history, if there is any loss of speech, babbling, gestures, or social skills, that should be taken very seriously. So in nutshell, what are the red flags? If by 6 months there are no big smiles or other warm, joyful expressions, or child is not interested in toys, by 9 months, if there is no back and forth sharing of sounds, if we are smiling, the child should smile. If we are producing some sounds, the child should try to mimic. Or if we are laughing, the child should show some sort of expression. If this is missing, by 12 months, if there is lack of response to name, there is no babbling, the child is not saying even a single word, no back and forth gestures, not responding to our gestures, no pointing. If child wants something, then child should be able to point with the use of index finger, or child is not waving, or child is not reaching out to us, not showing any emotions. By 16 months, no spoken words, no imitation. And by 24 months, no two-word sentences. Or child is repeating words like picolalia. So absence of joint attention is very, very important. This should be taken seriously. What are the early red flag signs for communication? If child does not babble by 1 year of age, does not point to objects or people by 1 year, does not make meaningful gestures by 1 year, does not speak one word by 16 months, does not combine two words by 2 years, speech is not understandable by 24 months, does not respond to name or loss of language or social skills at any age, and decreased use of non-verbal behavior, because non-verbal communication comes first. So if child is not having even non-verbal communication at the age of 2 years, that is a very, very serious matter. If child speaks in an abnormal tone or voice, which you can't understand, if repeats your question or repeats one word again and again, uses language incorrectly, or has difficulty communicating his needs or desires, and child does not understand your simple commands or simple directions, and lacks humor, because children with autism spectrum disorder, they generally behave like a robot, even if they are talking, and they lack humor, and their tone is monotonous. So these are clinical clues for possible autism. This is for a screening. We are using AmChat. This is AmChat. We have earlier had so many webinars on AmChat, so I will not go into details. You can always download it from the net. This is the scoring for low risk. We have 0 to 2 for medium, 3 to 7, and high risk 8 to 10. Thank you all.
Dr. Priyanka, you can stop screen sharing.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Priyanka. Thank you, Dr. Rafat, for an excellent talk. And we will now take up the questions. Those who want to ask questions can unmute yourself and ask. Meanwhile, I'll take up the questions in the chat box. Dr. Praveen wants to know, what about these corona times where there has been no social interaction? Will this affect the normal development of the child?
Definitely. It has been the biggest problem in this time. Most of the parents are coming to us. They are puzzled. They don't know how to interact, how to spend time with their child, quality time. So they are putting their children on the screen again. There are no therapies for these children. They are not going for occupational therapy, for speech therapy, nothing. So we are asked, in this condition, we are suggesting parents to spend quality time with their child, not putting them on a screen, because that is again aggravating their situation. They are again coming back to the original condition. So how can they spend quality time with their child? We are asking, depending on the condition of their child, because every child is different. So we are suggesting few games to them. We are suggesting that you can dance with your child. You can use different sketch pens, different types of colors. You can do coloring with your child. You can do craft. You can do puzzles with your child. And you can give simple commands to your child. Keep your child engaged. Or you can put good audio. But don't show screen, no videos.
In fact, they can be involved in simple age-appropriate household chores. So if you have no help at home, at your home, and you are, you know, going through this, just don't put them on screen, because we have seen a lot of children coming to us with speech delay and, you know, self-stimulatory behaviors and aggression. A lot of children are coming, and it is definitely impacting. I'm sure, Dr. Priyanka, you are also
a lot of children are coming, and parents are really in trouble. They are having a very tough time.
One thing we should always advise parents is, be any age category, spend some quality time in the evening. Make it a fixed routine. Like, you take out that fixed routine for your work, put that fixed routine for to spend with your child, so that he is engaged and, you know, you discuss with him. This is very, very important.
Dr. Praveen wants to ask a question. Dr. Praveen,
you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Wonderful talk. Really enjoyed it. How many kids you have seen, those who have required really a need of pediatric psychiatrist or a psychologist these days?
I think many. Yes, we have referred children to pediatric psychiatrists. Some children whom we are able to manage by ourselves, we are doing that. But yes, the pediatric psychiatry visits have increased considerably in this time.
Thank you so much.
And even in adolescents.
Depression is on rise, even not only in children, but with parents also. They are facing issues with parents also. They are also feeling very low in this time, because they are doing everything at home, and in spite of that, they are handling a special child all alone. So parents are also, especially mother is also feeling very low in this time.
Absolutely.
Dr. Arun Vadhva wants to know, can auditory hypersensitivity be normal in some children as an isolated subject?
Definitely. I have seen auditory hypersensitivity in many normal children.
Just that,
and this tactile self-stimulatory behavior also I have seen in many normal children also.
But you just have to correlate it with the other findings. If it is just auditory hypersensitivity and nothing else, then you need not worry. But if you have something along with it, then of course you have to investigate.
In severe cases, are you using MERT nowadays for these kids? In severe cases who are not responding to occupational therapy and other things?
Me, not yet.
I'm also not using.
I think neuromodulation is not on a, you know, not a big thing yet in our country. Mm-hmm. And has been, you know, tried in the West. But yes, I have not even heard of a center which is trying MERT or any transcranial, you know, this thing as of now, not heard.
And what about the role of diet? A lot of people talk of dietary restrictions in autism spectrum disorder. Is there really a role, or is there still no evidence for a dietary modulation?
That varies actually. In certain children, I have seen that there is a benefit of giving fat-rich diet and protein-rich diet, and probiotics are also helping. But you know, this is not consistent. This finding is not consistent. So difficult to say.
If you're talking about the GFCF diet, so there have been many studies about this diet. But, you know, only if you have comorbidities like the GI issues or the celiac thing or the gluten sensitivity, only in those kids, you know, it is helping. And obviously, if you don't have gluten sensitivity, you cannot keep the child devoid of gluten. It has not been proven to be of much benefit in children who do not exhibit hypersensitivity to gluten.
Yeah, because people talk of leaky gut syndrome, and they say, also, is it a cause-effect relationship or is it just an association?
Ma'am, it is an association. Yes, it is an association. And if we have to start the GFCF diet, then we should involve a pediatric gastroenterologist, a dietitian, do the thorough workup, and only then I think go ahead with it. Because many studies, many children were started and they have not found a very positive outcome in children who did not have gluten sensitivity. So in gluten sensitivity, yes, it does, but otherwise I don't think.
Any role of DHA in this supplementation?
So there are many studies coming up with DHA, carnosine. So supplementation helps. There are long-term studies. So obviously, we cannot say that we give DHA or carnosine or, you know, B12 supplements and it will be all okay. But yes, these supplements improve the long-term cognitive outcome. So can be given intermittently, and also the dietary modifications, as far as, you know, you give high DHA in the diet, and you know, B12, etc.
Any role of probiotics in autism?
Dr. Priyanka,
I have given probiotics in my patients, but I have not seen improvement in all my patients. Improvements are not consistent.
Yeah.
Because we are giving certain other medications also, plus we are giving home therapy also, we are giving home program to mothers also. So not sure whether this improvement was because of probiotic only, and not all the patients is showing the same response.
I say there is no role anywhere.
But there is a lot of research going on this topic in US. And there are certain studies which are showing that there is improvement.
I want to ask a question. Most of the time I have seen maybe the special educators or the occupational therapists giving a stimulus in the form of junk food.
That's very, very bad. I really discourage that. That is not advisable at all. That's why role of developmental pediatrician sets in. Otherwise, these therapists, they are changing everything according to them, which is very, very bad.
This is what has been happening in many of the centers. You must have observed it.
You are absolutely right. I have seen giving them Lay's chips packet so that they can continue therapy. That's very right.
Absolutely.
And making them more hyperactive.
Absolutely.
So giving preservative things to the children. They are very harmful.
These are the things, these are the centers which don't have a pediatric neurologist or a developmental pediatrician who is overseeing, and they just, you know, continue doing things what they want to, how they want to. So yes, it is going on a large scale in Delhi NCR.
It is indeed. I have seen many, almost all the places this has been going on.
These therapies should be governed actually.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much.
What about vitamin D, magnesium, B12 supplementation? Because a lot of people swear it helps.
Nothing is documented. Like vitamin D, if you are giving to anybody who is deficient, will definitely work. It's same principle applies for autism also.
Yeah. And vitamin D, we have many more studies showing the neuropsychological effects and the benefit of vitamin D. Yeah. So maybe that benefit, but we don't know if it is, you know, pertinent especially to only autism and improvement in autism.
Lot of children with, say, like hyperlexia, who are into too much of reading and other things, they also develop communication disorders later on. So what should we label them as autism or
not at all? Because autism is a socio communicative disorder. This child will not have social things. You will have a very good history if you will talk to parents. This is simply because of the condition which you are telling. So if we will elicit history, then we will come to know that this is all because of this.
Like we do see a lot of children who have some obsessive compulsive disorder or something like that. They tend to go into a shell and stop communicating and are just concentrating. So and often get mislabeled as autism. So they are basically autism mimics. So these are the
comorbidities. A lot of psychiatric comorbidities also exist along with autism, like epilepsy, OCDs, and you know, anxiety, depression. All of these things are also there, which are comorbidities along with autism.
Does it happen that a person who is destined to become schizophrenic later on in life will show some of these symptoms in early childhood, akin to
autism? Not autism.
No idea.
Any more questions? The house is open. Please unmute yourself and ask.
Ma'am, this was out of a blue question, I tell you. Bahut zabardast question tha. Ki schizophrenic honge ya nahi honge? This is something even I never thought of.
Actually, most of the schizophrenia patients present in adolescence. The symptoms come in adolescence, but people say that they do have some kind of these autism mimics when they are young, and you know, they do have. So probably you never, know better, but
never heard of it, ma'am, for sure. But I think ma'ams can enlighten us if they have heard of it, that ASD people can get into schizophrenia.
Not known yet.
I've never heard it.
So if there are any more questions.
Two questions are there, ma'am, at chat box.
So in Ayurveda, they say excess of vat leads to autism and speech delays. So many Ayurveda acharyas would advise an Ayurvedic cocktail called syrup Saraswat Trishta to such children. Any role?
I don't know anything about Ayurveda.
People actually do go because they are looking for some succor, so they go to any alternative therapy they can find.
Even homeopaths are saying that they can cure autism, but I have not seen any patient getting cured by a homeopath.
I think that's not possible. Cure is not possible.
Yeah, I think it's only early intervention as,
yes. early intervention.
As early as possible.
Yeah, absolutely.
The synaptic connections, you know, as much as you can.
Yeah, especially in the first year of life, you should try to catch them early.
Yes,
absolutely.
Whether they are autistic or they are simply developmental delay, we should intervene early.
Yeah, so the message would be that even if you suspect them, you subject them to therapy.
Absolutely.
Even if later on they are not autistic, but you subject them to therapy.
You can prevent them.
You suspect an autism disorder.
Clearly autistic.
So like the first case, like I said, that there were two patients or two children who had presented, and one of my friend's nephew who presented with speech delay and, you know, going into his own world and autistic traits and self-stimulatory behavior. So by reducing the screen time and spending quality time and just, you know, 1.5 months of OT in that child really helped. So that was the devastating impact of screen when introduced in early life and the usefulness of the therapy. When used appropriately, it really helps. I mean, no harm in doing therapy, right?
I also see a lot of these children who come to orphanages. They also have a lot of communication disorder, probably because of whatever trauma they've gone through, or probably
lack
they don't get so much of the lack of attention.
Violence.
And the moment they are adopted, they just, blossom out and all the symptoms go away. So again, I think it's the stimulation by the adoptive parents.
Yes.
Which
no, I, ma'am, make a quick choice. Yeah, I wanted to ask something.
Yeah, sure. Arun, go
yes.
ahead.
So, I've always been wanting to know, practically it's been my experience also. Do you feel autism is more common in children who are adopted? Or even ADHD as compared to the normal parents, normal children?
Till now, after seeing hundreds and hundreds of autistic children, I have seen autism in 3 and 4 adopted children.
And they bounce back. The thing is, lack of environmental stimulation in these orphans, and when we give that environmental stimulation, when the parents are there to take care of him, interact with him, when there are siblings to play, people to interact, I think they just bounce back and will not stay autistic. So autistic has a definite multifactorial genetic role to play. I mean,
somehow I felt that it's a little more common, but I don't have any study or any finding somehow to say, but let's see, maybe someday I'll be able to tabulate the data.
That would be nice.
Thank you so much.
So, I think we don't have any more questions, so we call it a day.
Ma'am, there's a request. Please share the clinic addresses of the speakers, please.
Yes.
I'm not there in the group, so please, if somebody can share.
Yes, Dr. Rafat, if you can share your card on the group.
10 minutes back.
Later on in the night, you can put it up.
Yeah.
And Dr. Priyanka also.
Hello, sorry.
Ma'am, if you can just put up your card, your visiting card in the group.
Oh,
or
sure.
You can send it to Dr. Rafat and she'll put it in the group.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rafat, for an excellent insight into the mimics. And definitely we should look out for the mimics, because if we continue occupational therapy in the mimics, we will end up nowhere and we will be, avoiding a definitive treatment which can help them, And thank you, Dr. Priyanka, for letting us know the signs to look out for in every child. And thank you for a nice interaction. Thank you to the CogniCare team at Angelo. Thank you for your logistic support and for all the help. Thank you very much. Thank you to all the delegates who have attended the show. And good night, everybody. Hope to see you soon again next Thursday.
Good night. Thank you so much. Stay safe. Good night, ma'am. Bye-bye.
Good night, everyone. All the viewers on the panel. It was a nice interaction with all of you. Thank you. Good night. Good night, Nitya.
Good night.